Well, there were a lot of problems in the area, a lot of overfishing issues, destructive fishing, there was poaching going on. And there was really a need for a plan to help manage all the uses for natural resources in the park. And together with the Parks Authority, the Nature Conservancy was invited to assist with the design of the plan. And we used a lot of participatory approaches with stakeholders living in the park, outside the park. We set up a lot of meetings, and the process took a few years that led to the ultimate zoning plan and the 25-year management plan for the park. And it's really a legal framework that provides information, guidance, how the resources can be used for tourism, for conservation, for science and research, for fishing also. And there are even exclusive user zones designed for the people living in the park, where only the local folks from Komodo can fish, for example. So we've tried to be as inclusive as possible. My name is Willy Johani. I'm the country director for the Nature Conservancy's Indonesia program. Well, we did a scoping study and we tried actually several ideas for the park. We did fish aggregation devices. We developed tourism cooperatives with the village Komodo and Rinca to help some families with the carving of the Komodo dragons. And at the time, fish farming was very interesting because there was a lot of pressure on the reef done by cyanide fishing. And this was induced by the food fish trade. There's a lot of demand in Hong Kong and Taiwan until now for live groupers. And the best way to catch the groupers is with cyanide. So there was a striving, destructive fishing practice going on in the park. So the idea was born to see how we could make this trade more sustainable, at the same time provide an alternative income for the people and protect the wild populations of groupers in the park.
1, 2, 3, 4.
The mariculture hatchery we helped design and set up. TNC did the research and development part of it with the aim to substitute the cyanide fishing with farmed fish. And we designed community-based grow-out of the fish, engaging local communities around the coast of West Flores in the grow-out of the fish. And the demand has never decreased. The traders from Hong Kong, Taiwan come and collect the fish. At some stage, we invited a commercial partner to help us scale up the business and really make it a commercially viable operations. TNC remains in partnership with this company to ensure that environmental practices are upheld by the hatchery. At the same time, still continue to facilitate the agreement with the local fishermen and the hatchery for their alternative income. And the fish farming by the local people is an ongoing business, and we hope to engage more and more people. In this way, we address the cyanide fishing. The trade is sustainable and local communities can get a higher income from this practice. Yeah, we decided to establish Putri Naga Komodo PNK, which is a for-profit company with the aim to make the park financially self-sufficient in 7 to 10 years' time. The reason why we established a for-profit company for conservation is that we chose the vehicle for having a tourism concession in the park that provides us the ability to help develop infrastructure development within the 25-year management plan. And secondly, with a joint venture setup, we were able to mobilize more funding resources from multilateral agencies, for example, in this case, the International Finance Corporation. With this setup, we are also better positioned to operate as a business entity to ensure that we can maximize revenues for the company that will all be reinvested in the park to support park operations, conservation efforts and community development programs. So it's really trying to marry tourism business skills with conservation core competencies from the Nature Conservancy. And with this new entity, we were able to mobilize more resources, more core competencies, at the same time apply for the tourism concession in the park.